wondering what he's here to talk about? Cost of living. I mean, the rising cost of living so far in many areas of life appears to be proving almost unsurmountable. Added to that is the recent hike in the pump price of PMS. And even though we hear that certain aspects, certain foodstuffs are getting cheaper, just yesterday we heard from Mr. Bismarck Rwani saying that, you know, it's been said that price of tomatoes may have come down by 50%. If that is your experience, we would like to know. But let's have this conversation this morning with Mr. Kuro John Ngobo, who is head faculty and lead consultant, Popo Training and Consulting. He's a public affairs analyst as well. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much, Ayo.
Well, first of all, what do you make of the fact that on the one hand, we hear that the cost of inflation, inflation figures have slowed a bit.
Okay.
Cost of petrol has risen and price of tomatoes may have come down. What's happening? It seems like some kind of a ping pong that people are experiencing.
Okay, so first of all, inflation is essentially the steady rise in the goods, in the prices of goods and services. Mm. And when we mention inflation figures, they are not snapshot. They are over a period of time. Mm. So even though, great news, the rate of inflation has gone down a bit in the last month, the truth is the impact will not hit the market immediately. So because inflation is computed over time, that the rate of its rising has reduced. So it's not rising as much as it used to rise, is what is the drop in the inflation rate. Not that the actual prices of goods and services have now dropped. That will still take some time. Mm-hmm. So with things like the prices of tomato, price of tomato coming down and all, if we think about it seriously, some things are seasonal in nature. And for that reason, in certain seasons, there would naturally be more supply. Once there's more supply, price will come down. If demand remains the same and supply increases, price will come down. So there are things that can we can play around. After, I think the two biggest issues with inflation today in Nigeria will still be PMS price, premium motor spirit or petrol, and the US dollar, because we are very import dependent.
Well, please help me understand. So if PMS is now a major factor,
yes,
and hitherto inflation figures have been largely buoyed by the cost of food.
Yes.
Please help us understand.
So the one that directly hits us the most is food inflation. Mm. And two things continue to drive that. One is, I mean, many things actually, but they boil down to two. So if there's insecurity, they can't plant. When they plant and they harvest, they must pay some royalties. So they add the cost, transporting it to where they need to eat it. All those things are factors. But major issues would be what is needed to transport and store power. Because we don't have power in Nigeria, many people rely on diesel and PMS. So long as anything that is a cost input goes up, then the person who's selling will think, I have to recover my cost. So they add to their selling price. That normally happens. Then we're still largely import dependent. So we don't import too well. We don't really import tomatoes. We import tomato puree. Another tomato derivatives.
Which is very funny. We'll come back to that.
Really is very funny. But because we import what is needed to process the tomatoes, we import what is needed to transport the tomatoes, to store the tomatoes. And naturally, when any of those factors change, the prices will go up. We believe that the prices have gone down a bit now because certain things are beginning to happen in the market. It could be things as simple as there's more supply.
Okay.
And when supply is, there's more supply, usually price will come down a bit. But we're not out of the woods yet.
Okay. Now, the subject matter, Mr. Ngobo, is the rising cost of living.
Sure.
The highest is, of course, as you mentioned, food.
Sure.
When people eat, when people are unable to eat, or the cost of buying food is expensive, most certainly there's going to be some issues raised on that. But then there is also the cost of accommodation added to the space. Not too long ago, I think within the past 2 or 3 weeks or thereabout, we hear that accommodation, the cost of accommodation in Abuja in particular, has risen so high. People now go to the outskirts, and quite a number of places in the city center we hear are largely
vacant. You know,
vacant.
Sure.
So that there is that. We've also been, anyone who's been watching this space will see that the cost of health maintenance as well is something else that is also very, very concerning for so many people, out of pocket largely. Health insurance is not something people are embracing as much as they ought to embrace. So, is there, would you, can you identify if there are things that could ameliorate the pains of the high cost of living that Nigerians are not taking advantage of? This health insurance thing, for instance, there is the belief that if we took advantage of it, you know, it'll save on the cost of living. Are there other things like that that people need to be aware of and consequently take advantage of?
I think the major ones would not be outside of the individual or the family, would be within. The first is the person. Many people in Nigeria really don't plan their finances. And how do they say this thing? If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. People just get funds, do what needs to be done, and then continue to run, hoping, sometimes praying, that something changes. I think the major challenge we have in Nigeria today is planning well enough. And I'm sure it's clear at the government level, at the individual level. So ask a regular Nigerian, how much do you earn and how much do you spend in a month? They can tell you the earning part easily. Usually it's a salary. The spending part is difficult to tell. So Nigeria has a budget deficit of about 10 trillion naira this year. It's the same thing with most families. There's a budget deficit. We're spending more, or we need to spend more than we earn. A little planning could simply just make that work. And I'll show you how this works. Case in point, my first biggest example. If you pay rent every year in a country like Nigeria, why do you wait till the end of the year to look for rent when you earn every month? Why don't you save your rent every month? Now, the first thing that financial, these challenges bring, people have shortfalls in their finances, it brings stress. We don't realize that stress itself can lead to the health implications we're trying to run away from, and so many other things. So picture somebody, say David or a Tunde or a Musa, who decides that I earn every month, my rent is 1.2 million naira a year. I will take out 100,000. I will find somewhere to put it, even make more money from it, but I'll do it every month from my salary, such that at the end of the year, I can pay my rent without stress. And I'm not stressing myself and the rest of the world to help me pay rent when it's time to pay rent. It's not easy, trust me, but it starts with some level of planning. And what planning does is it removes distractions, right? You are getting married, I have to buy Ashwebi. If I have rent to cover for this month, I'm not going to buy you Ashwebi. Ashwebi is Nigerian for that uniform we wear. Yeah, simple things like that. I think the first thing is starting with us. We also take cultural issues seriously. People will look at me somehow. I need to do this in this way. Somebody dies, we have to spend a lot of money feeding the world and going back to our own spaces, things like that. I think it starts with us. People need to learn to understand money and to learn to plan it better. Of course, the natural thing to do is look at the finance equation, income minus expenses equals profit or loss. If I increase my income or reduce my expenses, I would have more of profit or more of a budget surplus. If you can't control the income that well, but the expenses are within your control. So if you don't plan them, things will take the money away. I call it the spirit of money, the one that just talks to you when you have money and says, let's do this and
that. We'll come back to that because it makes some sense. But I mean, you talked about health insurance as being one of the interventions that people can take advantage of. Yes. Are there others that you can?
Yes. So health insurance, first of all, I want to just mention this quickly. People don't think about taking them because they think it's costs. It's actually cost savings. And I really think we should take advantage of it more. The more you do out-of-pocket spending for your health, the more money you spend. So is there anything else in the society today that we can take advantage of? Other kinds of insurance could also help. I spend more if my car gets damaged compared to if I had insurance cover. Now, I won't get the money back in a year if nothing happens to my car, but I won't spend that money fixing my car if I had insurance. I think insurance is the way to look at it, but it's not just it. It's protecting what you have, maintenance of the things you have, planning the funds in your hands. Most of it, I think, is tied to us, and then we can begin to plug them in. Okay. Everywhere we go.
Now, you when you talk about spending, you talk about saving. I did a bit of a calculation. I failed maths when I was in secondary school, but I did a bit of calculation. Thank God for technology.
Devices, yes.
That if you have a tank that gets you to spend on the average 50,000 naira per time that you fuel your car.
Mm-hmm.
And you use the car every day, there's a chance that you have to fuel that car once a week. And I'm saying once a week for those who
Conservatively.
Conservatively. True. There are those who fill their tanks maybe twice or thrice in a week. So if you fill your tank once a week, 50,000 naira, and multiply that by 4 in a month, that's 200,000 naira. Now multiply that by 12. Now, that's there is no way, I don't know if anyone planned that kind of expenses when they entered into January this year.
I'm sure.
So when you talk about us saving, and inflation has a way of creeping up on your savings, on your earnings, the cost of living is rising, your income isn't increasing, how do we balance it?
Okay, so I'll pick two things I mentioned. The first one is slightly cultural, how people will see me. Then the second one is planning. And I'll talk about this one issue. So wherever I live or wherever I work, which is usually the commute every day, do I have people I can do something as simple as carpooling with? Do I have to drive every day? Becomes a consideration. Now, don't get me wrong. Public transport as an alternative to driving is not exactly going to ameliorate issues because it also is expensive. So why am I driving the car by myself with just me in the car every day to work? Can we agree in my office, for instance, that I will drive one day a week and five of us will drive one day a week, but we all commute together to work and back if we live in the same area? What I would do is cut my 50K a week to become 50K a month. So I'm not earning more, but then there's an opportunity to save more. The issues around there will be, I have to talk to my colleague who she would think I'm broke or he would think I need money. How will people see me? Get those things out of the way. Do Mondays, I'm driving. You drive on Tuesday. He drives on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. We live in the same area. We work in the same office. I will drive once a day. And I'm not buying fuel in your tank. I'm simply just joining you to work 4 days a week. That's why I said a lot of it is not outside of us. It's within us. It's how we do planning and how we address the way people see us and cultural issues.
But don't also forget that it sounds like you're making an excuse for government already. They have a responsibility. The federal government has a responsibility to ensure that life is not difficult for Nigerians. And just about 30 minutes or thereabout ago, my colleagues on Business Morning on Sunrise Daily were talking about the role of subnationals in easing the pressure, the cost of living on people. So are you making excuses for government?
No, I'm taking government out of the equation because if we'll be frank, government has failed us thus far. I'm being blunt about it. And the truth is we must continue to live whether there's government or not. I'll give you simple examples of how you can tell. I'm not talking of this government, governments. When was the last time somebody built a house around you and asked, please, where's water board connection to connect water to my house? When was the last time that happened? I can't remember. When was the last time we're building a house and we're not buying the poles to connect the lights to our houses? We've been government for a long time. We need to begin to understand the reality of life. We are fixing our roads, we are providing our own light, our own water. We've been government. Now, when government wakes up and starts doing things right, it will work for us. But in spite of government, we've survived till now, right? I'm not making excuses for government. I just took government out of the equation and said, let's begin to be real with ourselves. We need to continue to live. Subsidy is gone. Subsidy is still there. We are paying subsidy. We don't know. I am paying out of pocket for fuel every day in spite of government. So maybe one of the realities you face is keep talking to government, keep supporting, praying for government, criticize government if they need to be criticized, but understand that government or not, we have to survive.
Mm. Okay. Now, that said, part of the interventions that are out there, part of the efforts, should we say, of government is, for instance, the alternative to fuel.
Sure.
CNG initiatives and all, with all of the conversations and all the fears that people are experiencing. My colleague Kayla, for instance, I think even more where saying the mere thought of having a canister in their car is scary enough.
True.
So, but then there's that fear. There's also the argument that what you have in your tank, the tank in which you pour your fuel. It's as dangerous because it's not even as safe as the CNG canister.
True,
so where do we go from here?
One of the biggest challenges we've had between government and people in Nigeria is communication, effective communication. We have a national orientation agency and it's time we began to shake things up in that space. Before we started talking about CNG and conversion and government putting money into training people to do it, the communication should have been clear. So I'll give an example. When I was a kid, I learned that getting on a bike wearing agbada or babariga was bad. Because I remember one advert from a very old TV station where they were talking about road signs. And I learned what that yellow crossing lines meant from that advert on TV. And they showed a guy on the Babariga on an Okada, on the bike, a motorbike, and explained how he could get caught in the wheels, he could catch fire. And I shuddered, but I have not forgotten until today. I think the first thing we should have done was to properly let people understand what you're talking about today. Fear is the presumption that something bad could happen. It is not just from a religious perspective, faith can counter it. Information can counter it too. If we're communicating better, the trust deficit will be lower. People will accept things faster. People will understand. I think that's the biggest challenge here. If government really wants us to begin to think that way, and it's good for us, if it's going to cost us less, if gas is easier to access, it's communicating it better. Maybe getting people who do skits every day to begin to work in that direction. Maybe.
Well, that's a good one. Perhaps one consideration for them. But then now we've talked about, you know, fear. How about food? Now, when I was growing up, since you talked about where you were growing up, let me also talk about when I was growing up. You know, right. My mom, whenever she wanted to wash pepper, you know, she would get the water of the pepper she just washed and pour it somewhere
close to the house.
Close to the house.
True.
There was a garden there. So on the other side of the kitchen, that garden is also always there. So sometimes when we needed to make egg or something, we just went to that garden, pluck a thing or two. So and there, that kind of thing would be what they call today urban farming.
True.
There is water, aqua farming, there is, you know, war, you know, all kinds of things that happen now. But generally, farming, agriculture, it doesn't look appealing such that we've heard this said that the people who are more into farming now, they are the older people.
Yes.
So young people are not as into it as they should. That's a risk for the future, isn't
True.
It?
True, it is. I have a 13-year-old daughter. We call her the Joy Princess. Since she was 5, whenever we travel in intercity, she asks me one question. Daddy, why is there so much bush and people are hungry? We come from a space where we see beggars on the streets. Then we see empty land, vast expanse, with greenery everywhere. And she doesn't get why we're hungry.
She's 13.
She's 13 now. She started asking when she was 5. That thing has troubled me till date. What you said is apt and very true. I don't want to speak to the whole of Nigeria. We can't all farm. Let's also be frank with ourselves. I think the least that should happen is anybody that has a square inch of space that you can call your own should put something there. So if you are not breeding butterflies, reduce the flowers and put tete and shoko and something in that space would be my own opinion. That would be the starting point. Everything we are supposed to be planting are the things we are wasting every day, like you said, with your mother's garden. So I think the mentality should first of all, let's even start with survival mode. I just want to eat tomorrow. The easiest way to eat tomorrow is to have the food available to you today. So what if we start doing that before we go into proper commercial farming? Let's just do the one where whatever waste I have, I find some way to make use of it. So any square inch of land you have, don't think interlocking stones first. Don't think flower gardens with lovely trees and aesthetics and cool. Let's put food there. Now, for those who don't have food and don't have land, you will find land that nobody's using, right? The chances are that if you begin to plant, an owner will show up. Then the owner will tell you to pay some stipend for using the land. They usually don't chase you away. They just tell you to pay some stipend for it. If you want to go commercial on it, that's one way to do it. Then we elite people who don't want to get our hands dirty, could we finance people to do the farming for us? Mm. Could we fund small-scale, smallholder farmers? Could I find you with a piece of land that you are fenced in, but you can't build for the next 2 years, and can come to an agreement where one hungry person who's willing to farm can go there and plant on behalf of the two of us, and we split the proceeds? The proceeds don't also have to be cash. They could be the yams we planted. I'll give you one simple example that makes me know this can work. So I was living in Abeokuta and I had land in my compound. So one day we ate watermelons and gave someone to throw the seeds away. Usually there's some watermelon juice in it. So the guy, instead of throwing it away, did this all over the compound and walked away. Now I left it as grass because I didn't want to put interlocking stones and all. I had dogs in the compound and all of that. So one day I called a gardener and said, weed. And he said, oh God, please don't remove this one. Don't remove that. I said, what is that? I said, it's watermelon. Ayo, in 3 months, no fertilizer, nothing. I harvested 67 plum watermelons on land in Abeokuta. I sold 50, gave out a bit and ate the rest. That's my way of telling people this thing can work. We don't have to bring food from the north. We don't have to do anything special. Let's just think survival. And I think that will change the way we do things.
You know, we could go on and on here. We could actually have a seminar here right now. how people can maximize whatever it is that they have. Because I think, you know, generally the issue really has always been, where do we start from? So for anyone watching now, if you can just do this in 30 seconds, what would be your first recommendation to anyone listening to you right now? Where do we start from on reducing the cost of living? I know you've said a few, but where do we start from?
I think the first thing is our mindsets. We should start with our mind. Focus on surviving you and your children and maximizing every resource available to you. That means where you need to cut, cut. Where you need to change, change. Maybe custard and pap taste exactly the same. It's the quantity of sugar that changes it. You know, maybe those are the kind of things. I think it's the mind. I don't think it's outside of us. I don't think it's a function of the resources we have outside of us. It's a lifestyle change thing. Mm. We're still very concerned about how people see me, what people will say. People will not be there if the hunger becomes really bad.
Or people will be there and say, what were you looking at? Anyway, as I said, let's not start that seminar right now. Kurojohn Gobo, head of faculty and lead consultant, Purple Training and Consulting. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much
for your time this morning. Well, Kayla, I know you have a guest there. I'm sure you guys are already starting that cooperative conversations.
Indeed, we have. We have missed her. And she's here.
Well, I have missed you too.
Hi.
And I'm happy to be back. Happy to be back. Yes, one had a good rest, but it's sad to see that the subjects haven't changed.
No, they haven't.
You know, of a soot walking cost of living. And I think that we have to commend our guest this morning for giving us some very commonsensical ways to, you know, just live through this time. And I don't know, how are we preparing for the Edo elections? It's this weekend.
I mean, yeah, it's upon us. The conversations have started. The peace accord issue, you know, PDP not signing that peace accord and having their demands and whatnot, put some sort of strain on the idea that we're going to have a peaceful exercise. We don't know what's going to happen. But the Inspector General of Police has read the riot act to everyone. So we'll be like this.
Fingers crossed.
We'll be like this. It's so good to see you again. Welcome back.
It's great to be back.
Yes.
Quite a lot to, you know, really mull on, especially with also the floods in Maiduguri.
Yes.
And how you have also been on that matter as well. Wait to see just what will come out of whatever. Is there an investigative panel?
You know, I'm watching to see what steps the governor would take, because Professor Zulum is not someone who would let this lie down or let this, you know, just continue. I feel like there's going to be, I know that there is an investigation going on into Alau Dam, you know, where were the fault lines there, you know. So that particular investigation will in many ways lay down the law on how these things are supposed to be done and what people should be very careful of, you know. So that's something I'm looking for. But before we wrap up, we do have some breaking news from Kogi State. The director of the Yaya Bello Media Office, Mr. Ohiare Michael, he says Yaya Bello has honored the EFCC invitation. I think we're going to be giving you more on that in the news bulletins to come. But right now, I think we have to take a few messages. Would you like to do us the honor, Mark?
Oh, well, yes, I do see that we have quite a number of feedback. It's interesting to note that the seeming distrust now between government and Dangote, or like controversy, is still on. And this feedback is from Professor Enakina talking about the conflict of interest by NNPCL and other interests in the presidency is frustrating and stifling Dangote Refinery from operating its business. Nigeria will not attract massive FDIs with incessant interference that is in contrast with federal government fiscal policies in revamping the economy. That's the first one from Professor Enakina.
I like to call them our co-hosts on the program because they send us messages every day. Second person, Festus Akimboyewa, says there's no doubt that NNPCL bought Dangote's PMS at wholesale price. If that's the case, NNPCL must pass on the lower wholesale prices to Nigerians. Federal government, Dangote, and other stakeholders must not hesitate to call out NNPCL if they're ripping off Nigerians by not passing the wholesale price to Nigerians buying petrol at the pumps. And I think Mr. Professor Nakana sent another one this morning.
I'm yet to see that particular one.
He says in most states, he's really going in on the states on this one.
Yeah.
In most states where kidnappings, referring to our security issue earlier, in most states where kidnappings and banditry persist, there's a scramble for solid minerals. There's lack of proper border controls as people just walk through our borders without proper identification and verification. There's prevalence of illegal firearms. There's continuous herder-farmers conflict, non-prosecution of sponsors of these criminals, and terrorism. Thank you all so much for your messages this morning.
Yeah, just once again, the breaking news is that the former governor of Kogi State, Yaya Bello, has honored the invitation of the EFCC. It's not clear, you know, just before we brought this to you, you know, the former governor had been invited by the EFCC, not just invited, but also being prosecuted by the EFCC. And there's been, you know, a bit of logjam in the case as the defendant had refused to show up in court. But it does appear that things are about to, the tide is about to turn. It's unclear what this will eventually spell out. But this is the news that we have for you, that the former governor of Kogi State, Yaya Bello, has finally honored the invitation of the EFCC, and we certainly will be bringing you more on that particular story as we have it.
Yes, and our correspondent actually said that she's actually requested for the visual, because I think this happened, it didn't happen today, I think it's happened yesterday or so. But all of the details will be coming up, so stay with us right here on Channels TV. And that is where we wrap it up this morning on Sunrise Daily. Have a wonderful, wonderful day ahead. I'm Kayla Magwa.
Thank you so much for watching. I'm Maopwe Ogui Yusuf. Ayo, it's good to see you.
Well, it's good to have you back, Maopwe. Have a wonderful day, everyone. See you tomorrow.